good morning, everyone. Welcome to Bridge Online. Hope that you guys are doing well this morning. Let's press into this song, Battle Belongs. We learned it a couple weeks ago. Let's sing it again this morning. Let's give our battles up to Him.
Power of our God. worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things.
My name is Emily James, and I'm the pastor of Connections here at The Bridge. If you're joining us for the first time today, I want to say a special welcome to you. And if you'd like to know more about The Bridge and who we are, we would love to connect with you further. To start, you can email us at hello@thebridgemarkham.com, or you can also visit us at thebridgemarkham.com/new. And be sure to fill out our connection form there. We would love to hear from you and connect with you and send you a special gift. We're a family church that loves meeting you where you're at and journeying with you. In fact, we're thrilled to announce that we'll be hosting another online parent seminar. Leanne Cabral, who walked us through cultivating prayer practices in our families back in November, will be joining us again and encouraging us to embrace the challenge to lead our families and kids towards a strong faith in Jesus. While the focus of the seminar is for children, many of the overarching principles are also transferable for youth and teenagers. So head to the link on the screen to sign up. Even if you aren't able to participate live with us, you can still register and we will share the recorded seminar with you afterward. We can't wait for this special time of encouragement and learning together again. Before we hear from Pastor Karen this morning, we want to give you an opportunity to give. We've heard time and time again from those in our community of how the Bridge goes above and beyond to bless people through ministry, through gifts and donations, through partnerships, and so much more in our community. Follow the links on the screen for ways to give. And thank you for supporting the life-giving work of Jesus in our community, region, and our world. Finally, here at The Bridge, we group for growth, where there are three ways for you to get involved. For some, that may look like joining a life group, or if you have questions about faith, maybe signing up for Alpha is for you. Perhaps you're looking to get unstuck in life and gain momentum in living. In that case, seasonal groups is perfect for you. Check this out.
Hi, I'm Anna Anandarajan, the Care Ministries pastor at The Bridge, a Markham Community Church. Current research shows that there have been prolonged and significant damage to public mental health during these past 6 to 7 months. We want you to know that we are here for you. Don't walk this journey alone. Come and join one of our seasonal groups and let's journey together. Whether you have experienced a loss of a loved one, loss of a relationship due to divorce or separation, dealing with depression, stress and anxiety, or struggling to manage your finances, or simply needing to enrich your marriage, we have a group for you. Seasonal groups are short-term support groups that journey together with people going through similar situations to provide you with the resources and comfort needed for you to overcome the challenges you may be experiencing and help you along in your journey so that you can experience hope and healing in the midst of it. We are offering 5 different seasonal groups online this winter. They are grief care, divorce care, overcoming depression, spiritual practices to overcome stress and anxiety, and the marriage course. Whether you have gone through a loss or you're looking to enrich your marriage, we have a seasonal group just for you. And you can be part of these groups from the comfort of your own home. So why not take that first step and join one of the seasonal groups that meets your need and experience community, connection, encouragement, hope, and healing. For more information, visit our website, seasonalgroups.com. We hope to see you soon.
Also, happening tonight, Life Group Connect. Make sure you register and come join. And if you're new, would you join me for Discover the Bridge next Sunday? I'd love to meet you. So the topic at hand today in this series on the life of Joseph is, who am I? This is still one of life's biggest questions, of course, followed by what's my purpose, which Pastor Samuel covered 2 weeks ago. If you were to finish the sentence, I am blank, how would you do it? Why don't you do it right now, actually? Put it in the chat if you would be so courageous, or write it on a sheet that you're taking notes on. I am. I'll give you just a minute. I would probably write, I am a wife, I am a mother, I am a nana, I am a pastor. Some of you might be so bold as to write, I am an addict, I am depressed, I am guilty, I am inadequate. None of this is actually wrong, but I hope that through the life of Joseph and then exploring further into the life of Jesus, our eyes will be opened to something more grounded, more transcendental, and more foundational. But first, the continuing story of Joseph. At first glance, the story of Joseph, and in particular this chapter 39, all seem to be the stuff soap operas are made of. But really, there's so much more to it than that. Let's take a closer look at what happened in Potiphar's house. The young man Joseph, sold into slavery by his jealous brothers, is taken to Egypt and there becomes the property of Potiphar, a wealthy and powerful man described as an officer of Pharaoh. The very next thing the Bible tells us is that the Lord was with Joseph. Even Potiphar sees this, and the Bible says that he saw that the Lord caused all that Joseph did to prosper in his hands. So Joseph is a success, and Potiphar makes him overseer of his entire house. So after the storyteller has described Joseph's great success and position of responsibility, telling us repeatedly that Potiphar has put him in charge of all that he had, we come to an unexpected sentence, one that doesn't seem to have any bearing at all on Joseph's status. It's a short sentence, and it catches us by surprise. Now, Joseph was handsome and good looking. On top of all the other great things going for Joseph, he's good looking. Some people have all the luck, don't they? Or do they? In Joseph's case, his good looks turn out to be one blessing too many. Why? Because the wife of Potiphar desires Joseph, and she is determined to get him into her bed. Remember, Joseph's a slave. He's a slave of hers and of Potiphar's. If the mistress of the house wants him to do something, he has little choice in the matter. It will be a power move, a superior telling a subordinate what he must do. "Lie with me," says Potiphar's wife to Joseph. It's not a teasing come on. It's an order. Think about that for a minute. Joseph resists the woman's advances. He appeals to her sense of justice. "Look," he says to her, "with me here, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put everything that he has into my hands." Joseph asks her, "How then could I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" Joseph recognizes the betrayal of his master is also breaking God's laws. But his appeal gets him nowhere. The Bible says the wife continued her campaign day after day, but he stood his ground. Finally, one day, when the two are alone in the house, she grabs him by his clothing. Joseph does the only thing he can do. He flees out of the house, but leaves his garment in her hand. Now, I think to cover her embarrassment, to save her reputation, or maybe simply out of revenge, Potiphar's wife screams and everyone comes running. She tells them a lie, accusing Joseph of trying to have sex with her. When her husband comes home, she tells him the very same story. Now, this has become an impossible situation for Potiphar. The man he has trusted with his house and everything in it, the man to whom he has given stewardship of the most intimate things in his life, this man, Joseph, is accused of betraying that trust. When Potiphar heard the story his wife told him, it says he became enraged. He took Joseph and threw him into prison. So doesn't that mean Potiphar was enraged with Joseph and believed his wife's story, believed that Joseph had done wrong and deserved to be punished? Well, not necessarily. The normal punishment for the wrongdoing Joseph was accused of was not prison, it was death. In this, Potiphar's way of appeasing his wife and protecting Joseph might have been his thought pattern. This chapter ends with scripture telling us that the Lord was with Joseph. So let's call out the question on most of our minds. Joseph, how did you do this? Well, to fully understand Joseph and to bring it into our own context, let's go over to the New Testament, to another that was tempted and resisted. And this, of course, is Jesus. We're going to go to the book of Luke. Now, the first three chapters of Luke give us the context of Jesus' birth, a tidbit about his childhood, that when he was 12, he was left in the temple and his parents didn't even miss him. Anyone else do that? And then jumps to the introduction of Jesus by John the Baptist when he was about 30. That's all we know of him up until this point. And this begins with his baptism. Immediately following his baptism, he scoots over to the desert. And I wonder if he knew what he would experience there. Luke 4, verse 3 says that when he was in the desert, the devil came to him and said, "If you're the Son of God, tell this stone to become bread." He's saying, "Come, Jesus, prove yourself. Show us what you can do." And then the devil led him up to a high place and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. And he said to him, "I will give you all their authority and splendor. It has been given to me and I can give it to anyone I want to." He's saying it's all about having all of this. This will give you power. And then the third time, the devil led him to Jerusalem and had him stand on the highest point of the temple. "If you are the Son of God," he said, "throw yourself down from here. Nobody really knows you. If you want to be accepted, if you want to be noticed and followed, then I would advise you to do this." Who am I? Isn't it interesting? The three ways in which Jesus was tempted are the three identities we tend to mark our own lives with. I am what I do, I am what I have, and I am what others say and think about me. Let's unpack these just a little bit. I am what I do. Whether you're a lawyer, a teacher, a student, or whatever, it's so easy to use what you do to define who you are. If you feel extra good when things are successful, then that's great. But you might feel horrible if they're not. Then it's a good sign that your worth is centered in your accomplishments. The problem with this is that your identity is based on something that can fluctuate wildly, causing you to question whether you are enough. And then, I am what I have, both tangible and intangible. Your social class, your ethnic background, relationship status, education, looks, material possessions. This may make you happy for part of your life. You know the saying that money can't buy you happy, but it sure can buy you chocolate. But you lose these things through change or loss or ultimately death. It leaves you feeling worthless and helpless. And then I am what other people say about me and think of me. Popularity wins the day. You let others define you and name you. And you believe them. You live on people's approval, on their encouragement, and on the likes on Instagram. But the moment you're criticized or questioned or disliked, your sense of worth goes out the window. You begin defining yourself by those things, a loser, a failure, and you wonder if you're truly loved. If you're honest with yourself, you'll recognize how much of your life goes towards securing identity through these three ways. How many times have you wondered if you were enough for your boss, for your mother, for your kids? How many times do you feel yourself comparing yourself to others? How many times have you felt worthless, unloved, unaccepted? And the driving force behind how we act and feel is what we believe. Really, we are not surprised that Jesus refused to give in. He wouldn't let the enemy name him and rob him of who he really was, because you see, he knew who he was. If we look just a few verses back in Luke at the close of the baptism, we see that when he came out of the water, the sky opened up and God the Father said this, "This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased." God the Father sealed his identity, sealed Jesus' identity as the beloved as he was baptized. And do you know what? This is yours and mine as well when we choose to believe in and follow Jesus. You're not left alone trying to prove who you are. You are not defined by a title, a position, a GPA, a resume, a mirror, a bathroom scale, likes, attraction, struggles, or the past. God says, "You are my son. You are my daughter, chosen and marked by my love, pride of my life." Who, me? God, really? And God says, "Yeah, really." How hard this is for us to really believe. Of all the spectacular things in the world, in the heavens above and the oceans deep, we are one that Jesus sings about. Zephaniah 3:17 says, "He will take delight in you with gladness. With his love, he will calm all your fears. He will rejoice over you with joyful songs. His heart overflows with love for you." Let that revelation sink deep, deep down into your heart and your soul. You are not just some random person that God occasionally remembers. The entire book of the Song of Songs, not often read, by the way, is crazy and almost explicit with the overflowing of God's unending love for you. He cherishes you. He enjoys you. He believes in you. You are the apple of his eye. Brennan Manning says, "Define yourself radically as one beloved by God. This is the true self. Every other identity is illusion." Our lives should be shaped in response to this. Mike Foster, author of Rise Glorious and the Rescue Academy, he says that identity is still one of the biggest questions. And he has this great diagram that he's given permission to use. And so let's walk through this together today. Identity is core to helping people understand who they are. So many things get in the way of really living this way. So much distracts us and pulls at us. And then there's pain and trauma and suffering. This causes us to forget who we are. We go into this foggy place and believe we're unworthy, we're shameful. We start thinking we're hopeless, and things and achievements take over our lives. So we need to come back, or sometimes be brought back to the core of things, of who we are. And so at the very, very core of every single person is the image of God. Now, this is not Instagram, IG, the image of God. This is non-negotiable. You're made in the image of God. It is stamped onto your being. You can't change that. You are a reflection of your Creator. And then around that, we have another identity. This we will call our core identity. And this core identity is that you are the beloved. This is the truth of who we are. We can't fight it. We can't deny it. Everybody who calls himself a Christian, who loves Jesus, has this identity. We are the beloved. And then there's one more layer here. And that is the strengths and the gifts that you possess. Now, this is where you become unique, that we are different from each other. But all of this has been poured into you. God has put it into you, and it's part of your identity. And then rounding it out is the body. Yes, this body. Sometimes we forget it, but it's the container of our soul and of our spirit and all that stuff. So this is truly who we are. But here comes the problem. Most of us don't see ourselves as this. We don't live from this identity. We live from what is called a false identity or a false ID. And that false ID, it's outside of us. It's out here. It's not who we really are, but we make it ours. This false ID is perfection. This false ID is performance, or it might be addiction or a whole host of other things. But the reality is, it's fake. It's not who we really are. What it is, that false identity, is how we protect our hearts. But God doesn't want us to live out here. And so my greatest gift to you today is to take you, not from the problems. That's where a lot of people want to start. They want to start with the problems. They want to start with the dysfunction. But if we do this, we run the risk of only getting some modified behavior. We make it about us and what we can do. So don't you agree that the best way is to go right to the core? Take people right to where they belong, right to they're created in the image of God and are a reflector of their Creator, and they are beloved, loved beyond your wildest imagination. Now, a couple of weeks ago, Pastor Brian reminded us that God is the hero of the story. You recall him saying that. The hero, he gets to give names to his participants. And he names you beloved. He names you son and daughter. That is who you are. Now, let's move over to the book of Ephesians for a minute. The Apostle Paul, who planted the church in Ephesus a few years previous to when this was written, has some things to now address with them. He is hearing of anger and rage. Some were slipping into their old patterns of sexual immorality, some into gossip and theft and lying. things so inconsistent with being followers of Jesus. But Paul, where does he start? He doesn't start with those things. He doesn't start with the mess and the sin. In chapter 1, he starts with, remember who you are. Remember God loves you. Remember how he dumped his mercy on you. In the first 3 chapters, he reminds them about their true identity. He says, if you've heard the whisper of God and responded to the voice of Christ, you know that God picked you up and welcomed you into the family, and you are his. You see, he went after their core identity, not their behavior. He says, remember who you are. And he keeps going. He reminds them that Christianity or following Jesus isn't about doing enough for God so that he finally likes you. No, he says, you have been bought with a price. You have been redeemed through Jesus' work on the cross. You're his. Jesus has paid the price. And your identity is now in him. Author Brennan Manning says, my deepest awareness of myself is that I am deeply loved by Jesus Christ, and I've done nothing to earn it or deserve it. An identity that is not achieved, but received. Received by grace, a gift of God. Paul knew that knowing whose you are is key to changing the mess you're in. We discover the person we already are in Christ and live from there. His outrageous love will turn you into a different man, a different woman, if your focus is right. It is not get rid of this and you can become that. Rather, God says, you are this and you have no need of that. We discover the person we already are in Christ. We discover our belovedness and behave accordingly. What you focus on is what you live from. At group on Tuesday night, my friend Deborah commented that there is a confidence that comes when we know we are deeply loved. Yes, your one yes, your yes to follow Jesus makes thousands of no's possible. So back to Joseph where we began. How did Joseph remain faithful? How did he not give in to all the temptation offered him? I think we could say Joseph knew who he was. You see, he was raised in a very God-conscious culture. He knew he was the continued promise carried on from his ancestor Abraham to bless all the nations. He knew who he belonged to. Also, he knew he was the apple of his father's eye. Sure, there was dysfunction there because of favoritism, but still, Joseph knew he was special. He knew he was loved. And most importantly, as Pastor Brian revealed to us in the opening message, Joseph never took his eyes off God. He knew where his identity lay. When we are rooted in our core identity, we have focus, we have boundaries. Joseph, we saw, had both. Not just in his encounter with Potiphar's wife, but throughout his whole life. Because of this, his life had the freedom to make the right choices, freedom to say no to all the things that his yes now had no need for. Like Jesus, Joseph didn't let anyone or anything rob him of his true identity. We all want to be in a place where we know for certain we're loved, we're accepted. To know that security and significance and satisfaction will never be taken away from us. We want to know that the rug will not be pulled out from under us. We want to know where our identity is found and where our needs are met. We do want that, and we can have that. It depends on where you're looking for it. Many people who profess to know God and even profess to believe in Him don't have this genuine heart conviction that God loves them, that they are His beloved. Is that you today? Are you saying, why would God love me? Well, because that's who God is. He is love. And that makes you who you are, beloved. I'm going to share an image with you to close. When you throw your arms around your kids, or around your friends' kids, or around whatever kids you happen to be around, you throw your arms around them and tell them that there is nobody in the world like them, that you love them to bits, and that that will never change. How do they respond? Don't you just see that big smile on their face? Don't you see them stand a little taller? And don't you see them make better choices? Well, do you know what? That's the same picture of God and us. So how about every day, close your eyes and see God throwing His arms around you, telling you He loves you to bits, and there's absolutely nothing that can change that. Nothing living or dead, angelic or demonic, today or tomorrow, high or low, thinkable or unthinkable, absolutely nothing can get between you and God's love because of the way that Jesus, our Master, has embraced you. Can you just feel that love drive a little bit deeper into your heart and your soul?
The highest King would welcome me. I was lost, but He brought me His love for me. His love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child. Yes, He died for me in the sunset.
joining us this morning. Make sure you check out the description box below this video for any links that you'll need, not only today, but also into this week. And we'll see you next Sunday. Until then, bye for now. Oh,